So I wanted to walk through some of the things that you were telling me about the differences between original art and production art. Now, mm-hmm. what exactly were they?
Oh, well, you mean like from a technical standpoint?
Yeah.
Original art is the original art board, usually in pencil and ink form, i.e. there was a penciler who is the main credited artist, right?
Right.
And then an inker that inks on top of the penciler. And in many cases, you know, fully or at least partially erases the pencil marks underneath to create a clean finished product. So
gotcha.
It's a collaboration between the penciler, who essentially is outlining the actual what the image is, right? So that's why he or she, why the penciler is usually the main credited artist.
But because they created the art, yeah.
Right, because they created the image. But the inker or finisher, to use another term for it, is the one that sort of, you know, creates the, I guess, the final outline based on what the pencilers put down on the artboard for that OA page to be turned into production art, which is essentially a copy of that, which will then later get colored by a colorist, right? At least that is the old school method. These days, right. A lot of that stuff happens digitally. A lot of the coloring happens digitally. So there's a lot of differences, in the comic artist landscape with the technology and evolution of the industry. But
yeah,
that's how it worked in the old days. And there's still some guys that do traditional, you know, pencil and inked art today, but not as many.
Okay. Now, when they lay out the word bubbles and the mm-hmm. the lettering, right? Is that part of that process or is that a separate process?
Back in the day, it used to be part of the page itself, like either literally physically onto the page or with like stat bubble, you know, like literally like superimposed stat. My stat means like a static copy, like on another piece of paper, essentially.
Right.
Either glued or taped over it as an overlay, stat overlay. Nowadays, I think, you know, in the 2000s and since, really, lettering is not usually on the page. So a lot of more modern pages, like in the last 20 years, whether they're penciled and inked or they're inked over blue lines, which is a totally different thing, don't have the lettering. I see, you know, there are collectors now in OA that pay other people to make the lettering, like to have the over, you know, have that superimposed over as like a, you know, like an overlay essentially on a piece of plastic, like whether it's the trade dress missing on a cover,
yeah,
or you know, or the literally the word bubbles on a panel page. So you could, if you really want the words on there, if you really want the comic book trade dress on there, and you bought a modern cover that, you know, modern covers don't have the trade dress on the cover, right, for the original art. So there are collectors that kind of go the extra mile to sort of make the piece look as close to the original published as possible, but it's not, you know, that's kind of a taste thing, you know. You hear different things that might increase resale value. I don't know, there's really a scientific study for that or necessarily, you know, but I could see that, because, you know, it looks, for certain collectors, having that trade dress or having the story on the page adds value to the collectible or to the experience of owning that piece.
It certainly looks cool. Yeah. I mean,
that's why I really love pages though from the 90s and older, because the word bubbles are on the page. You know what I mean?
Right.
We have the story on there. Yeah.
Oh, that definitely makes sense.